I'm going to read from Judges chapter 6, verses 36 through 40. This will be from the New Living Translation. This has to do with Gideon putting out fleeces. Beginning of verse 36, it says, "Then Gideon said to God, 'If you're truly going to use me to rescue Israel as you promised, prove it to me in this way. I will put a wool fleece on the threshing floor tonight. If the fleece is wet with dew in the morning, but the ground is dry, then I will know that you're going to help me rescue Israel as you promised.'" And that is just what happened. When Gideon got up early the next morning, he squeezed the fleece and wrung out a whole bowl full of water. Then Gideon said to God, "Please don't be angry with me, but let me make one more request. Let me use the fleece for one more test. This time let the fleece remain dry while the ground around it is wet with dew." So that night God did as Gideon asked. The fleece was dry in the morning, but the ground was covered with dew. And so it's from this passage of scripture that we get the phrase of putting out fleeces. Now, God will sometimes answer prayers like that, particularly for young believers. But under the new covenant, we are to depend on the Holy Spirit for guidance. And we got to make sure that whatever guidance we're perceiving is in line with God's word. I mean, God's not going to lead us to do something that contradicts his word. I can recall maybe one or two incidents of well-known ministers who put out fleeces and God answered them. One of them is Benny Hinn. In his book, He Touched Me, he talked about how God used fleeces to confirm it was God's will for him to marry a woman named Suzanne. One example was Benny was flying back to Orlando where Suzanne's parents lived. She was visiting her parents for the holidays. She was going to college back then. Benny asked the Lord that if it's his will to marry Suzanne, then have her make me a cheesecake. And that's exactly what happened. Another example I can think of involved John Kilpatrick. He was the pastor of Brownsville Assembly of God in Pensacola, Florida, where they had the Brownsville Revival back in the late 90s. Well, about the time John was preparing to step into full-time ministry, I mean, he knew he had a call to preach, and he was asked to consider pastoring this particular church. When he was asking the Lord to confirm that he was supposed to pastor this church, when the board voted for him, they voted 100%. John took that as a confirmation. It was time for him to step out in full-time ministry. He had a good job at the time with the utility company, but even though this company offered him a lot of benefits, he knew he was called to preach, and he quit his job and took on the pastor of that church. Now, I also know of ministers that have been misled by fleeces. Kenneth Hagin is an example, and he had a similar incident, but ended up being not God's direction for him. Early in his ministry, Kenneth was asked to pastor this one church in Texas. And so he asked the Lord, said, "Lord, if I'm supposed to pastor this church, have the board vote for me 100%. Well, that's exactly what happened. And Kenneth took on the church. He was there for a year, but he felt out of place. And he later realized he didn't follow the leading of the Lord. He took an outside circumstance to determine it was God's will. Another minister I can think of who got misled by a fleece is Matt Hammond. He's a pastor of Ludinger Christian Center, which was my home church during the 90s, and I still visit there from time to time. Early in his ministry, Pastor Mack needed to get some air conditioners for his church. Back then, he played a little game with stoplights. Came up to this light, and he would think to himself, if the light stays green when I go through, it's going to be a good day. But if it turns yellow or red, better watch out. It was a seemingly harmless game he played in his mind, but ended up taking a momentum of its own. So one day, Pastor Mack was on his way to the bank. He was going to talk to his banker about borrowing some money to buy two air conditioners for his church. On his way to the bank, he saw a light up ahead. It was green, and he thought to himself, okay, if that light stays green, that means I'm going to get my loan. Well, the light turned red before he even got anywhere close to it. But rather than continue on to the bank, Pastor Mack drove straight back to the church. He called his banker, and he said, "I'm sorry, I can't make it today. Something has come up." He didn't tell him it was a fleece. Well, then the banker told Pastor Mack, "Well, that's a shame, Pastor Hammond, because the bank president has a free time, and I was going to introduce you to him." Pastor Mack wanted to meet this bank president, and God had set up a divine appointment. But instead, Mack got fleeced. He got misdirected because he used an outside circumstance to determine God's will. So I share these things to caution you about putting out fleeces. Now, in my own life, God has often used signs, usually to confirm direction, but sometimes he'll use signs to get our attention. And one example is God leading me here back to Minnesota. A couple weeks ago, I was in Virginia. The Lord had led me to go up there. I attended part of winter camp meeting at Calvary Campground. I also spent some time staying with friends in Northern Virginia. Well, one day I went to visit the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C., first time I've ever been there. And while we were getting a tour of the place, I noticed behind one of the old pulpits, I saw the state flag of Minnesota. I thought that was kind of peculiar. And so I asked the tour guide about it, and he said that every week they pray for a different state of the cathedral. That week happened to be Minnesota. And I was perceiving in my spirit, this was the Lord signaling to me that I was supposed to go to Minnesota. And I already had thoughts about doing so, but I wasn't certain it was the right time. And so I simply asked the Lord to clarify that direction. We need to allow God to decide how he's going to guide us, you know, whether it's through a sign, we might get a rainbow word in our spirit, or we might be reading the Bible and suddenly a thought will come to our mind and say, that's what I want you to do. Well, what happened a few days later, some of you might remember Billy Graham had recently died. His body was laid in state at the U.S. Capitol. And since I happened to be in the D.C. area at the time, I decided to go to the Capitol for the viewing. My friend John, another missionary, he was also in the area, and we agreed to meet at the Capitol. Well, he got in line before I did. He had emailed me informing me that he was standing next to some people from Minnesota. And I was perceiving in my spirit that this was a sign not only for me to go to Minnesota, but also for John. In fact, let me back up a little bit. God actually already given me specific direction about Minnesota. I remember I was on my way walking to the bus stop. I took a bus into D.C., and the Lord had instructed me to leave for Minnesota the next day. And so then John informed me hours later that he was standing next to some people in Minnesota. And so I'll make a long story short, we ended up making a road trip here. What I'm trying to say is God will use signs to confirm direction, but we shouldn't look for signs. Good rule of thumb to follow is that signs follow believers, but believers are not to follow after signs. And so if you're seeking direction from the Lord regarding a particular matter, it's not wrong to ask God for confirmations. It says in James chapter 1, verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all liberally and without reproach. And Jesus also said that God will confirm his word in the mouths of two or three witnesses. So again, if you're sensing God's leading you to do something, but you're not certain it's his will, ask him to give you a confirmation on that. But let God decide how he's going to do it. You know, you might send someone across your path that might say something, and it'll bear witness in your spirit, say, yeah, I'm supposed to do this, or no, I'm not supposed to do this. But also spend time praying. Lay still if you have to. You know, spend some time being still before the Lord and ask God to give you clarity of direction. We can all hear the voice of God. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and the voice of a stranger they do not follow. If necessary, spend some time fasting. You know, if you have a lot going on, if you have all kinds of thoughts going to your mind, learn to be still. As it says in Psalm 46, verse 10, I believe, be still and know that I'm God. We can be so busy, it's hard to discern the voice of the Lord. You sometimes just need to be quiet, ask God to show you what to do, and he'll make it clear to you. You know, God's not withholding from us. He wants us to be in his will. He wants us to follow his plans and direction for our life. But we need to make sure he's first place in our lives. We're not allowing outside activities to take up too much of our time and our thought life. We need to be quiet and let the Lord speak to us.